Welcome everybody. Today we are going to start the pharmacology principles. We are going to go over the main topics. And the first one we are going to talk today is about what is the definition of pharmacology. All right, here we have the pharmacology principles, and we will talk about the medications errors of how to prevent medication errors. Okay, so let's start. So first of all, what is pharmacology? Pharmacology is the study of the drug, but it's not only that. The study of the drug that is in interaction or interacting with the body, with the living organisms. And that is going to happen through different chemical processes, chemical reactions. So we have the activity of these drugs are going to be doing two things. Number one, increase or decrease the body functions. So pharmacology, as we already know, the drugs are not going to create new functions in the body. They are not. What they are doing is to modulate. They are going to increase. In case of, for example, too much gastric acid, what is doing the medication? Decrease the gastric acid. In case of low levels of thyroid glands, what you're doing is to give thyroid glands, T3 and T4, in order to increase the function. So pharmacology is about that. So we don't create new functions. They are going to just increase or decrease or modulate the functions of the organs. So pharmacology is not only just the study of the drug. The study of the drug in relation or interacting with the body, and we can explain that through knowing the mechanisms of action, the chemical process. All right, so let's keep going. So here we have the definition of the drug. We have other components. We will talk today about the pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics, that those are the main components of the of pharmacology in order to understand the drugs. We are going to use other components like anatomy, physiology, chemistry, and pathophysiology. Okay. So just remember, drugs do not affect a physiological process, so they are going to regulate the physiological activity. Okay, so let's start talking here. We have the how to name the drugs. Chemical name, we are not going to use chemical name. Generic name, we are remember, we were going to use the lowercase ibuprofen, for example, ibuprofen, and we have the trademark name, proprietary name is with capital letter. In this case, is going to be the Motrin. So, Motrin is ibuprofen, right? Motrin is the generic name or trademark name, and the ibuprofen is the generic name. So, who approve the generic name? The FDA, and that is called now the official name. All right, so let's keep going. So one, some few here things about nursing considerations. Nursing considerations, the nurse, what they need, how to communicate with the patient. If the patient is asking or is going to receive a medication, you need to you need to explain the patient, give two names, the brand name, the trademark name, and the generic name. Why we are doing that? Because it's easier for the patient to remember the trademark name, that is more commercial rather than the generic name sometimes. But we must give the two names to the patient. Okay, so here we have some examples of generic names. So just pay attention here in the trademark, generic name, lowercase, all these guys. And uppercase, we have the names here in the trademark name. All right, so there's different ways to name farms. You can say, okay, cardiovascular medication. You can say gastrointestinal medication. You can say the therapeutic action or clinical indications. For example, I have an infection, you have, you're going to use antibiotics, bacterial infection. If you have gastritis, you're going to use antacids. Physiological or chemical action. So according to the mechanism of action, you're going to see the anticholinergics. Anticholinergics, you can have, for example, calcium channel blockers, right? So ARBs, you can have different the cholinesterase, for example, anticholinesterase inhibitors or MAO inhibitors or COMT inhibitors. We are going to see different enzymes that can be inhibit in order to increase some neurotransmitters, for example, right? All right, so let's keep going here. We have the pharmaceutics, pharmacokinetics, and pharmacodynamics. Pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics are the main beam of what is pharmacology principles. So let's start this. This is three yellows. We are going to talk about these three first. Let's start talking a little bit about pharmaceutics. And pharmaceutics, can you see here an idea? Is just the presentation and the way that the pharmacy industry is going to introduce the medication safety into the market. For example, in the form of tablets, pills, injections, IV, IM, subcutaneous, etc. So pharmaceutics is the process on which a chemical is used safely and effectively. It's going to be designed to give the presentation, the dosage, etc. So that is pharmaceutics. In conclusion, that is what is going to do the pharmaceutical industry. Second, we are going to see what is the pharmacokinetics. Pharmacokinetics is the study of various drugs form influence the way in which the drugs affect the body. So in conclusion, I want you to remember pharmacokinetics is how the body affects the drug. How the body affects the drug. So that means that, for example, what happens if you have poor absorption in the medication? Absorption. Let's stop in absorption a little bit. Absorption is how your body is going to affect the drug. So the body do not absorb the medication properly. So that means that the drug is not going to pass in enough amounts in the body. It will not make that effect. All right, so we have four stages of pharmacokinetics. Number one, we have absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion. We are going to make it simple, straight, and definitely I think it's going to be very, very useful to have some definitions and go to the point about each of these stages. Absorption. Just remember, ADME, ADME, ADME is universal. Everybody do this mnemonic. So, and that is important. Why? Because in NCLEX or other exams, they can ask you what is the order. So it's not this order is what you need to follow. First is absorption. Second is not this. Is distribution. Second, third is metabolism, and the last one, fourth, is excretion or elimination. So that is going to be the order. One, two, three, four. No other way. So metabolism is biotransformation. So it's sometimes a synonym about metabolism biotransformation, because what is biotransformation? Is transformation of a substance to another substance. That is biotransformation. Distribution is going to be the distribution is going to be when the after absorption they go to the bloodstream, but then in the bloodstream is going to reach the receptor in the cell. So that is the distribution. When they reach the target organ, the target receptor. So distribution is not just running into the blood. So absorption, what is absorption? Is when the movement of the drug from the lumen, means the space on the intestine, towards the wall, passing through the wall of the intestine and go into the circulatory system. Period. That is the end of absorption. Then once it's in the circulatory system, they're going to reach the target organ. So it's going to circulate by the blood and reach the target organ at the level of the receptors. So blood receptors, keywords here, distribution. Metabolism is biotransformation, transformation of one substance to another substance. So mostly metabolism, what they are doing is inactivate the medication. But in all some cases, they can activate the medication. So this metabolism can happen in every single cell, can happen especially in the liver. Excretion. Excretion is the how we get rid of the or eliminate the medication. So we have metabolites that can be inactive, that is passing through the metabolism, and they are going to be eliminated through different areas. So how we eliminate substance in your body? Urine, right? Feces, right? Exhalation, so exhale, so respiratory tract. So those things, we are going to see that in the next few slides. Okay, so here we have as a conclusion, pharmacokinetics, how body affect the drug, pharmacodynamic, how drug affect the body. So please, one thing to remember, pharmacodynamics is drug first, D and D. Okay, so it's a way not to forget about. Pharmacodynamics is how the drug affect the body. Okay, and the opposite is, we have two keywords, body and drug, drug and body. Who is first? In pharmacodynamic, drug, and second is body. Pharmacokinetics is the opposite of the, let's put it this way, just to remember, opposite of pharmacodynamics, you have the body first and the drug second. So what is pharmacokinetics? Is how the body affects the drug. And pharmacodynamics, how the drug affects the body. All right, so let's keep going. We have here absorption. What is absorption here? Is the movement of the drug from the site of administration into the bloodstream. So they need to pass through the abdominal wall. And what happened? These medications should be with the right size in order to be able to absorb into the mucus. It's too big, they are not going to pass. Number one, right? And that is that absorption is going to be related to the route. So more absorption depends to the route. PO absorption, so I mean enteral absorption. So if you take the pill, you swallow the pill, is the absorption means, as you know, the medication pass into the circulatory system. Okay, so for the enteral, when you take it, you need to wait until it's absorbed. But if you take it in the route IV, you put it directly on the blood. So absorption is going to be different between the, for example, the PO or the enteral with the parenteral that is the IV. So the absorption in IV will be about 100%, right? Meantime, the absorption in the is going to pass the first pass effect, the bioavailability that we are going to see in a few moments. All right, so let's keep going. We have we are going to talk about the second is the distribution. Remember, number one is absorption. Number two is distribution. Drug transport by the bloodstream to the site of action. So you can put in parentheses here the receptor, okay? And that depends on the circulation, of course. If the circulation is poor, and is narrow the vessels because of diabetes or hypertension or slow because of heart failure. So the distribution of medication is going to be different and it's not going to reach the target organ. In another sense, we have distribution. For example, we have proteins. Proteins are going to be transporters of the drug. So remember, the proteins are are going to link to the medication, and when they link to the medication, they are not going to be making action on the target on the receptors. They are not. Only the free that are not attached to the medication, that's not attached to the drug, are going to make effect. But this link of the protein with the drug can be link and unlink. So it's going to be like reversible process. So some moments are going to be linked to the protein, sometimes are going to be free from the protein. And is the moment when they get free from the protein, they are going to reach the target organ. And they come back, and then the rest that was not finding the receptor yet, they're coming back as link with the protein. So the more proteins and the more affinity of the drug to the proteins, the drug obviously is going to last longer in the blood because they are actually helping like a storage that are going to release slowly the medication into the target organ. So we will discuss that again in a few moments. So let's talk about metabolism. Metabolism, the key word that I want you to remember is the biotransformation. It's the same, biotransformation. Biotransformation, what it's going to do is mostly inactivate, but some medications can be activated. Example, we have the benzodiazepines. Benzodiazepines are going to be activated. Other medications can be inactivated. So we are going to see that there is some enzymes that are going to be specific for inactivation and other enzymes for activation. Okay, so we have, and that depends of the enzymes that are going to be, for example, the P450, we are going to see in the next few slides. Excretion, elimination of metabolites, and they are going to depend on the GI tract and the urinary system. All right, so let's keep going. So absorption. So think about absorption. Let's focus on absorption. So we are going to see three main things. The bioavailability, the first pass effect, and route. Bioavailability, please, is not a concept that is totally independent from the first pass effect. So this first pass effect is going to be related to the bioavailability. And the bioavailability, the same with the first pass effect. So it's like a medication when it's passing through the GI tract, you take the pill, go to the stomach. The stomach is going to have gastric acid. The gastric acid is going to dissolve the medication in some components that are going to destroy some part of the medication. And then this remaining percentage of the medication passed to the duodenum. And in the duodenum are going to be lost some percentage of this medication. They are going to go to the feces, and another percentage, they are going to be absorbed. When this percentage of absorption of medication go to the bloodstream, they go to the portal vein and they go to the liver. And in the liver, these percentages are going to be used only part of that again. And at the end, you will see that about 1/3 or 25% or 30% depends of the medication can be used as a therapeutic effect. So if you take the pill, go to the stomach, intestine, portal vein, liver, at the end, from that 100% of the pill, you're going to be used probably 30%. And that is okay because that is are the studies that have been doing the pharmaceutical in the industries, and that's what the normal body do to the drug, pharmacokinetics. And those studies, based on those studies, they give you that amount because they are going to just reach part of that, and that's what we need. Okay? Is that clear, I guess? So bioavailability, let's start with bioavailability. The sorry, there's no we are not going video. Okay, so let's keep going. Okay, so definition of absorption. Absorption is the movement of drug from the site of administration to the bloodstream. Movements from the intestines to the bloodstream, that is simple. Depends on the route, of course, the absorption, and you need to remember that the slowest will be the enteral, the PO, by mouth, and the fastest is going to be the ID. All right, so let's talk about the first pass effect. And look at this cartoon here, the first pass effect. So we have first pass effect, medication, intestine, liver. Medication, intestine, liver. So that is are the components. The medications go to the intestine. Some of them are going to be going to the stools. Some of them are going to be going to the portal vein circulation. Then they are going to go to the liver. The liver, some of them are going to eliminate it through the bile. Some of them is going to enter into the circulatory system. All right, so number one. First of all, this is the first pass effect from the mouth to the liver. And to get there, you need to pass the intestine, the portal vein system, and the liver. So that's why it's called presystemic. Okay? The systemic circulation, in this case, we are going to mention as they are when they're coming out from the liver, so passing the liver. But in between the mouth and the liver, that is going to be the first pass effect. So what is going to happen is we have what we call the hepatic degradation. Hepatic degradation. This hepatic degradation means that some medications are going to be eliminated through the bile, and another medication are going to be passing to the circulatory system. Okay. All right. So here we have what we was just mentioned: intestine, the portal vein, liver. We have that is the same to say bioavailability, right? So the bioavailability is the amount of drug that is going to be used. For example, you have bioavailability of 80%. That is high. So they are going to see from the 100%, 80 will be used. 80%. Bioavailability of 20%. So bioavailability 20% means that 80% is going to be lost and only 20% is going to be used. Okay? So now what is a prodrug? Prodrug is an inactive drug that it will be activated. So remember, when the liver is going to do two things. Mostly, the majority of the cases is going to inactivate the drugs. Okay? Inactivate. And mostly of them, they are going to be activating the drug. So we are talking about we're talking about metabolism. We are going to see in a few moments. But for this moment, the prodrug is an inactive medication that you take it. So when you take it, it's not active. And they are going to be activated in the liver. That is a prodrug. We have some enzymes, for example, the P450 system, and we are going to see that in a few moments. All right, so bioavailability. The bioavailability is a percentage of drug absorbed and available to the target tissue. Okay? Now, another very important concept, open eyes, open ears, the bioequivalence. A bioequivalence is when two different drugs are absorbed in the same amount in order to have the same bioavailability. So two drugs that they have same availability, for example, 20% absorption, that are are bioequivalent. All right, factors affecting the absorption. So absorption can be affected, right? If you diminish the area of absorption, of course, there is going to be less absorption. If you decrease the time of passing through the medication through the intestines, that is going to decrease the absorption. If you have poor circulation, the poor circulation is not going to make able to absorb from the lumen of the intestine to the blood. Solubility. Solubility is, first of all, solubility, when we are talking about solubility, you need to think about two things. Number one, the cell membranes of the intestine, the cells. So the drug need to pass through the cells, not between the cells, through the cells of the intestine. So these membranes of the cells are liposoluble, right? Liposoluble. So any medication that are going to be liposoluble or no ionized, so no charges, So not ionized, or they are going to be liposoluble, are going to be easier to pass through that membrane. That's it. We don't need to remember that. I'm not going to ask that, but it's very important, for example, to have some, to understand how, for example, vitamin A, D, E, and K, those are fat-soluble vitamins, fat-soluble. So fat-soluble, and the cell membrane is fat, is liposoluble. So that's why they can pass very easy. The rest are going to be more difficult to pass through the membrane. So it means absorption. In conclusion, so liposoluble medications are easier to be absorbed by the intestine. Absorption, increased absorption. Hydrosoluble or water soluble are going to just be more difficult to be absorbed. Drugs, higher concentration are absorbed more rapidly. So the more concentration you take, the more absorption you have. But of course, we need to follow the therapeutic range because you can get into toxic levels. Bioavailability is after the first pass through the liver. So, for example, we have IV, the bioavailability. IV, what is doing? It's going to have 100% of bioavailability, and it's going to bypass the first pass effect. So that's why. So everything that is passing to the first pass effect are going to not be 100%. Some of them are going to be lost. Routes, we have enteral, parenteral, and topical. Parenteral is the fastest. Then we have sublingual, then intramuscular, subcutaneous, rectal, and at the end, the slowest is going to be the oral. Okay? All right. So we have another consideration that we need to keep here mentioning is, for example, you decrease gastric acid. So the pH of the gastric, so that means more acid, right? If you decrease the pH, it's more acid. More acidity, so it's going to break down faster the medication, so it's going to be faster absorption. So what we need to keep in consideration that elderly and young people, they don't have the same amount of gastric acid. So, and all the trials that they've been doing in the pharmaceutical industry is about average people. That is the majority of the people, right? So in general, what we do is to decrease the dose when it's children, in the majority of the cases. And adult elderly people, we decrease the... We decrease to the amount of those, for example, for elderly people. About we start about 1/3 to 1/2 the medication. General rule is not always the way to be to happen that is happening, but is actually a guide. So we have factors that are affecting absorption. We have additives. So some medications are going to be surrounded by, for example, starch. Sometimes they put colorants, some dual colorants, that means they have some taste because the medication is very bitter or another components around. So this additive can actually change the absorption of the medication. Enteric coating, that is very important to focus. Enteric coating dissolve only in alkaline pH 7. So if you crush or you bite or you chew it, the enteric coat, they are going to go directly to the stomach where it's acid that we want alkaline. In acid, what it's going to do is totally inactivate the medication. So the coat is like already studies in pharmaceutical industry that they know that this amount of coating is going to be enough to protect the main ingredient until the stomach make them pass to the duodenum that is more alkaline environment. So those studies are being done, so it's not like magic. So they are being doing trials and experimentation, and they know how much of this enteric coating is enough in order to resist the gastric acid, and they are going to pass into the duodenum where that is the moment where they are going to be dissolved properly. Sustained release drugs, so those are SR sustained release that is a slow release, and LA is the long acting, So they are going to produce, we are going to talk about lozenges another time, but these are small capsules that inside they have small ingredients with coating at the same time. And they are going to be released slowly, slowly in the intestine. So that's why it's called SR or LA. Size of drug particles is important because some medications can happen what we call chelation. Chelation is what I see here. So this is before eating, before taking the pill, and they are going to be chelated. What does it mean? So if you take, for example, tetracycline, very common, or you take, for example, fluoroquinolones, or you take some macrolides like erythromycin. So, and you take it with milk, for example, or food. What they are doing is the food and the milk, they have, for example, these elements, ions like iron, like calcium and magnesium. So this can trap, or they can link to the medication, and what happened? This is chelation. So you will say, well, so what? All right. So this is bigger than this, right? So making it bigger is going to delay or inhibit the absorption of the medication through the wall of the intestine. Right? Makes sense. All right. So let's talk about routes: enteral, parenteral, and topical. So there is other books that can dissect a little bit more, but we are going to talk about these three main things. Enteral route is the drug is absorbed circulating through the oral or gastric mucus or the small intestine. So we have, for example, the oral, the sublingual, the buccal, the rectal, and the NG tube. Okay, so a few things here. The most common type of drug presentation is going to be enteral. Why? Because it's cheaper, it's more accessible. Enteral means, remember, it's intestine. Most of the drug will be absorbed in the small intestine, even though that some can start being absorbed from the stomach, but it's very few percentage of that drug. Mostly, and the majority, I will say 95%, 99% are going to be in the small intestine. The distal third of the rectum partially avoid the first pass. So the rectum is something we need to talk kind of interesting, because the rectum are going to return the blood supply into the IVC, directly to the IVC. So that is going to bypass the first pass effect, right? But some part of the rectum of these vessels can drain into the inferior mesenteric vein that goes to the portal vein. But these are not that many, not that much. Most of them are going to go directly to the IVC. But what we call the vesical or rectal, inferior rectal veins. Anyhow, so distal one-third of the rectum partially avoid the first pass effect. So there is some first pass effect when you do suppositories. Constipation drug stay longer. So constipation, right? So the intestinal motility is going down. It's low. So medication is going to be more time in contact with the intestine. So what happened? You can have risk for increased levels of the drug or toxicity levels. So we need to assess the GI motility, especially in geriatric patients, in elderly people, because actually they have low motility. Okay, so PO drugs, absorption varies in form. We have liquids, elixirs, syrups. Elixirs are substances that they have higher levels of alcohol, and syrups, they have higher levels of sugar, okay? Alcohol, what is doing is going to do is is going, if you want to clean something that is oily, put alcohol. See how it's going to clean it, right? Very, very easy. So that's the same thing. Alcohol is going to help to pass the liposoluble membrane of the intestine. So that's why they put some amount of alcohol there, because it's going to improve the absorption. And syrups are going to be sweet, but why? Because the active medication, the active ingredient, is going to be very bitter, so it's not going to be desirable to take it. So that's why they put high content of sugar there. All right, so liquids is the fastest, suspension is the second, powders are the third one most. We are talking about enteral, PO, right? And capsules, tablets, coated tablets, and enteric coated tablets, those are actually the slowest. Those are mostly the lozenges, and then are the one who has a very slow release. Okay? All right, so parenteral route. So we have enteral and we have parenteral. Enteral, we just pass that, and the parenteral is they are going to bypass the GI tract by using the subcutaneous, the intramuscular, and IV. So IV is going to bypass the first pass effect. The fastest delivery into the blood circulation is the IV, but do not decrease the amount of side effects of allergic reactions. Through different routes. So that means that if medication has side effects, doesn't matter. If you're going to have side effects for that medication, doesn't matter what route you're going to use. The absorption is going to change, yes, but they are not going to change the side effects. Okay, side effects. So we have here the intradermal. We have, what is intradermal? Intradermal needle between the epidermis and the dermis. Meantime, the subcutaneous is in the hypodermis, is in the connective tissue. Okay? All right, so let's keep going. So topical, we have transdermal. We have, for example, the eyes, the ears, the nose, inhalation, sprays, for example, and areas, for example, the vaginal mucosa. They can be used as a topical route for absorption. So just remember, infants, we have a risk for toxicity. Why? Because they have, the skin are very thin. There is one of the layers are not very well developed yet, and they are not going to, they are going to absorb more even. If the baby is using diaper, the diaper is going to be like a cluster, right? Like a coated cluster, cluster that are going to increase the absorption of the topical ointment or cream. It's in elderly people, you need to remember that we have the skin are very thin too. So elderly people, thin skin. Young people, very thin skin. Thin skin in young people because they don't develop completely. And thin skin in elderly people because they lost one of the layers of the skin, making it more fragile, more thinner, and easy to absorb more medication. Okay, so we need to be careful on that. Distribution is, as you remember, is the drug circulating through the bloodstream, but reaching the receptor. So the key word is the receptor. So we have different components that are going to affect the distribution is the concentration of albumin. We was mentioned at the beginning albumin. Albumin is the taxi driver of the medication, right? So distribution, don't lose the perspective. Distribution is drug in the blood reaching the receptors. And in between, we have the medication running or flowing into the bloodstream, and they found albumin. Albumin is going to have, the medication have affinity in one or more or less degree, affinity to the albumin. So they will be attached or free drug. The free drug that is not attached to albumin is the one who make effect. Okay, so if albumin is decreased, if you have low levels of albumin, for example, malnourished patient, you have more free drug available, right? So this more free is the free drug is not attached to the proteins, means that make effect, right? So increase the concentration of free drug in blood So that means that more drug is going to find the target organ, so more risk for toxicity. So please, this think about the malnourished patient. They can receive full dose as a person who are very well nourished? Of course not, right? So why? Because if the malnourished have low levels of proteins in the blood, albumin, so there's more free drug, and the free more free drug is going to produce, can reach higher levels to lead into more receptors are going to be affected. So the effect is going to can reach toxic levels. All right, so distribution depends on the blood flow. So heart failure, for example, is poor perfusion, poor blood flow. Protein binding, so that means that some medications have more affinity or less affinity to the protein. We have solubility. Solubility, you remember, the one who are similar to the cell membrane are the one who are going to be absorbed easily. So we have the liposoluble. Liposoluble plus another things. I'm not going to mention that now. Like, for example, no ionized medication. No ionized medication. Weak acids. They are going to just pass very fast the cell membrane. Solubility, interactions. So interactions is going to be another slide. It's what is interaction? Interaction is when one drug affects another drug. Again, one drug is going to affect the activity of other drug. Make it simple. So that is interaction. It can be this effect should be increasing or decreasing or totally blocking the action of the other medication. Protein binding, drugs bounded to plasma protein have a longer duration of action. Okay, why? Because they are going to link and unlink. So that means that the unlink is going to start doing effect, but some of the unlink medication who is not making final receptor come back again to be linked to the protein. So, and in this process, go on back like a yo-yo, they are going to just they are going to be released slowly. So the more binding to the proteins is going to make the longer duration action of the drug. All right, so we have metabolism is the biotransformation. Just remember this, please. Is the process whereby the body inactivates drug. Wait, just a minute. So, but I just said that can be activated or can be deactivated, right? Metabolism is happening in any single cell of the body, any single organ of the body. The majority of these can happen in the liver, but every single cell are going to be able to do this biotransformation. So from the substance that become substance A become substance B. All right, so, but they can be activated, can be inactivated. The majority will be inactivated. But some of them are going to be activated, like we said about the biotransformation. Primary organ of metabolism is the liver. Other sides are the GI tract and lungs, okay? But every single organ actually is having the ability to do that. So what we are going to do, so in general, in the literature, and when you're reading, when you're talking about increased metabolism, that means that it's going to increase the deactivation. But don't forget that there is a component that can be activated, okay? But the majority is going to be deactivated. So when you decrease the metabolism, the deactivation is going to be lower. So you can reach toxic levels. Make sense? All right. So if you have good metabolism, the good metabolism is going to deactivate mostly the medication. And you are not going to reach toxic level. But if you decrease the metabolism, what happened? The deactivation is going to be poor, so you have more active medication. And besides to think that this really is bad, it actually can reach you toxic level. Depends on the medication. Some medication, they have very narrow therapeutic range. Other medications have more broader therapeutic range. So we will see that in a few moments. Cytochrome. So cytochrome P450 is actually what it's going to do is, first of all, it's located in all cell membranes of the body, including the liver, the lungs, the kidneys. The action is the drug metabolism participates in the formation. So first of all, this P450 is going to participate in the formation of hormones, sexual hormones like estrogen, progesterone, testosterone, for example, and a formation of cholesterol too, and the vitamin D. So those are the cytochrome P450, just to have an idea. And what is doing the P450, the cytochrome P450, inducer of the, some medications are, or some things are going to increase the cytochrome P450 activity. So what it's doing is to increase the drug metabolism. Increase the drug metabolism. Now you are going to understand something here. Alcohol. You cannot take alcohol with medications, right? Why? Because they are going to increase the drug metabolism. So that means that the drug is going to be inactivated very fast. Well, okay? And this definitely, that is going to be something against what is not going to be benefits for you. So St. John's wort, that is OTC, are going to do the same. So increase the metabolism activity of the cytochrome P400. So if you stimulate P450, that is going to increase the metabolism. Now, who stimulate or induce the activity of the P450? Alcohol. St. John's wort. Phenytoin, that is anticonvulsant. Carbamazepine is anti-seizure too, and for migraine. Rifampin is for tuberculosis. Barbiturate is for hypnotics, and rifampin, it's repeated there, is tuberculosis. All right, so in the other side, and that is my point for all these warning, inhibitors of P450, who is going to inhibit the cytochrome P450? So that means that they are going to decrease the drug metabolism. Decrease the drug metabolism means that they are going to decrease the inhibition of the drug. So you can have risk of toxic levels. And that's number one, you need to think about the grapefruit. So just remember, alcohol is going to increase the metabolism, and the grapefruit is going to decrease the metabolism. So the grapefruit decreases the metabolism, that means that you can reach toxic levels, okay? The grapefruit, in addition to that, they are going to produce some delay on the absorption, on delay of absorption. We are talking about the metabolism, right? So, but this grapefruit can do two things: delay absorption and decrease the drug metabolism. So it's going to inhibit the cytochrome P450. So the grapefruit. Okay, so we have 85 medications who make interaction with the grapefruit. So please, the best thing is probably, if you want to remember all the 85, well, you're welcome, but I don't suggest to do that. But definitely grapefruit, I prefer to think to avoid with any medication. Okay, even there are some studies that are doing saying some specific topics that I'm not going to mention now because can be confused for the student. Excretion, we have elimination of the drug, metabolites. What is metabolite? Metabolite. Metabolite is after the drug is being metabolized. You take a pill right now. They go to the cell, they go to the liver, to the lungs, to the kidney. They're going to be, so we have absorption, then we have the distribution, and then when the distribution reaches the receptors, they are going to be metabolized. When they are metabolized, the byproducts of these reactions are going to be called metabolites. These metabolites can be mostly inactivated. Some of them are going to be active ingredients, and they are going to be eliminated by different routes: GI tract, feces, genitourinary, the urine, respiratory system, the exhalation. So take a pill if you take antibiotics, for example, before, you go and see, for example, the urine, is going to smell like a diabetic. If you exhale, the air is going to smell like antibiotics. So those are the proofs that are being excreted by this route. And the feces too are going to be the same thing. Half-life of the drug is important to know because about definition is very important. Is the amount of time required for 50% of the drug to be eliminated from the body. So what does it mean? So half-life time is 4 hours, for example. Or let's make 6 hours. 6 hours. 6 hours. 6 hours, and the half-life time is going to be six hours. If I give 100 milligrams right now, today, right now, what night is 6 o'clock in the morning? At 12 o'clock, I'm going to have 50%. Now, from that 50 milligrams that I have at 12 o'clock, at 6 o'clock, I'm going to have 25. So every 6 hours. Or every 4 hours, depends on what is the half-life of that medication, are going to be decreased 50%. So if you give just one pill right now, only one pill, so in few hours, they're going to be 50% and disappear. Okay, so that's why we need to take one pill after another pill every 8 hours, every 12 hours. We have one pill a day if the half-life time is more than 24 hours, for example, right? If you give more than that, you can have reach toxic levels. But imagine, the curve of the first pill is going up and down. Then the second pill after 6 hours, 4 hours, are going up and down. And the third pill up and down. So what you're trying to do with that is that in about 5 cycles or five times that you give the medication, after 5 times, could be 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, the purpose is to reach an even concentration of the drug in the blood. Why? Because the waves, the up and downs that I was mentioning, are going to overlap. When it's going down, other medication is coming up. So at the end, you have a steady line during all this time of the medication. Okay, so that is about half-life time. Okay, so let's skip that. So I'm just going to mention first order excretion is the more concentration of the drug in blood, the more elimination you have, right? So that kind of makes sense, right? If you have a little bit, you're going to have a little bit of excretion. But if you have more, you have more excretion. We have the zero order. And that is some medications that we need. I just create this mnemonic, so please, if this is an extra. So zero order is a constant elimination. So what is the implication about this? That you actually cannot accelerate or decrease the excretion of this medication. It's going to be always the same level. For example, the warfarin. We have alcohol, aspirin, lithium, and theophylline are wealth. Okay, so that are actually is the same amount of it. It doesn't matter if you have high or low concentration of the drug. All right, so let's keep going. We have some definitions. Please, I want you to go over this. A steady state, intake, elimination of the drug are in equilibrium. Steady state, so is after 3 days. After 4 or 5 cycles of half-life time, you're going to have a steady state where the elimination and the intake of the medication is in equilibrium, making you have the therapeutic range, right, that we desire. Peak level, the highest, the throw is lowest level of drug. Toxicity occurs in the peak flow, is more than the peak flow, all right? So peak blood level, sorry, of the drug is higher than the peak, so that is where you have toxicity. And some drugs are very dangerous for be toxic, because even though if you pass the peak flow blood level, you can enter little by little into toxic levels in the best scenario. But in the worst scenario, and that's why we need to be careful with phenytoin, for example, warfarin, for example, after the peak level is reached, a little bit more, just one a little bit more, that is going to lead into toxic levels. So we need to be careful on those drugs. So those are actually warnings, alerts for those drugs. Warfarin, for example, heparin, for example. What else? Phenytoin, for example, right? Okay, so therapeutic drug monitoring, so long life drugs, digoxin, for example, 36 hours, just because its half-life time is longer, more than one day, we are going to give once daily. Okay, so we have the BBB, the blood-brain barrier, we are going to talk another time. This is a barrier, so that means that the nerve cells receive nutrients and nutrient from the blood vessels. So cell, nerve cell and blood vessel. So, but in between them, they have another nerve, that is the glia, give support. So this guy is the one who give, is going to filter all this blood content, and then this glia is going to give the filtered substance into the nerve cell, nutrients, oxygen, etc. So that is important. Why? Because the BBB is preventing the passing of bacteria, right? So this is going to, some medication can pass, some other medications do not pass. It's too early to talk about medications, but we have here the ceftriaxone, that is a cephalosporin, that is of third generation, that are going to pass. We have the placenta barrier. The placenta barrier, we have, for example, the placenta is going to have a filter. So it's important to know that insulin is a minimum passing through the placenta barrier. So what does it mean? Mother who need insulin can take insulin? Yes, they can take insulin because it's safety for the fetus. Can we use heparin? The heparin cannot pass the placenta barrier. So it's okay if the patient need heparin, they are going to use heparin. Insulin, heparin. But what they can pass and they can be very dangerous is cocaine, alcohol, caffeine, nicotine. And what they're doing, these guys produce vasoconstriction. So at the end, what you have, if the mother is drinking, and besides the baby is alcoholic or cocaine, at the end, they're going to have fast, that means fetal alcohol syndrome, or they have cocaine withdrawal effects at the end when they're born. That's mostly happening in the second and third day after birth. Caffeine, nicotine, all of these guys produce vasoconstriction. Vasoconstriction, less blood flow, less oxygen, less nutrients, the baby grow small. It's what we call the IUGR, the intrauterine growth restriction. So the baby is going to be smaller, and as a consequence, means that is just from outside, but what happened inside of the baby didn't have enough elements to develop or to grow. So IQ is going to be down. So they have some deficits, motor activities are going to be delayed in his life. Warfarin, so please, contraindication, don't give them, because they can pass the placenta barrier. They can pass the placenta barrier, so please. Warfarin is totally contraindicated. Tetracycline, chemotherapy, thiazides, well, is something that is new for you, but at least I want you to remember the warfarin. Okay, so as a summary here, we have the pharmacokinetics, we have ADME, as you see here. We have the absorption can be happen in simple absorption, simple diffusion, passive diffusion, and active diffusion. So those are the way how it can be absorbed. It can be enteral, parenteral, or topical, and the relation that we need to remember is the bioavailability and the first pass effect. I forgot to put here the pass first effect. Distribution depends on the blood flow interactions. The dose, the amount of proteins in the blood, metabolism is going to be, they can activate or deactivate, so that mostly happening in any part of the body, and mostly are deactivating, and elimination depends on the half-life of the medication. Renal clearance, that means that the kidneys need to be working properly, right? So if the kidney is not working properly, the clearance, I mean the clear up, let's put it this way, of the medication from the blood is going to be very poor. So this day we have the pharmacokinetics admin. Let's talk about the pharmacodynamics, and the pharmacodynamics is the study of the drug with does the body, what does in the body. So we have desired activity that we need to understand the mechanism of action, how the drug is going to make effect. I'm not going to go into that much detail, but it's helping a lot to understand. Especially are going to make incidence on the are going to make emphasis, sorry, in the mechanism of action with a group of medication that can actually save us a lot of memory. And the side effects are the side effects. So please, side effects, adverse effects, interactions, toxicity. So I will tell you just as a very shortcut. So pharmacodynamics, you can divide it basically in desired and undesired effect. Makes sense, right? Easy. And here we have the desired effects are, for example, if you have too much high blood pressure, you decrease the blood pressure. If you want to increase your dopamine in Parkinson, you can actually, that is the desired activity. So you're going to have, they are going to control the signs and symptoms of the Parkinson, for example. And desired effects, we have side effects, adverse effects, interactions, and toxicity. Side effects. Side effects, for example, you take aspirin, what do you have? Gastric irritation. Adverse effects are going to be more severe. Are going to be, for example, bleeding. You can have some bleeding in the stomach, okay? And but in general, we use side effects and adverse effects almost similar. So we already know what could be the main side effects and what are the severe side effects. And this is kind of something we need to live with, but people talk about adverse effects, side effects indistinctly. So, but we need to know that technically it's a difference between them, okay? All right, so let's keep going. One thing that I want you to remember is the desired effects. Desired effects are going to be the therapeutic effect. What is the therapeutic effect? Therapeutic, treatment effect. That's what you're looking for, right? If you have pain, you take a painkiller, that is what you want. Desired effect is to get rid of the pain. Well, not all the time you get rid of the pain, you can minimize the pain. So that's why we are going, you have pain management. So we will see that in another moment. All right, so we have duration of action. Another thing that we need to remember is time during which the concentration of the drug is enough to give a therapeutic response. Okay, duration of action is the time. Time where the drug is making action, in other words. So please, don't forget that. We have MOA, the mechanism of action, the way the drug produces actions. We have drugs that are going to stimulate the receptors, agonists, for example, alpha receptors, alpha 1. For example, we use alpha 1 vasoconstrictor where? When you have nasal congestion. So in nasal congestion, the vessels in the nose are, in the mucus of the nose are vasodilated, escaping water, producing edema. So we use alpha-1 vasoconstrictors to produce the opposite, vasoconstriction, the water is not escaped anymore, so congestion is relieved. Antagonism, we have, for example, beta-1 blocker. Beta-1, what is doing? Increase heart rate, beta-1 agonist means increase heart rate, and increased contractility. And beta-1 blocker, antagonist or blocker is going to do the opposite. It's going to decrease the heart rate and decrease the contractility. So that we use for hypertension, heart failure, etc. Competitive, there have been receptors that are going to compete for the same receptors. Non-competitive are going to be not specifically competing for the receptors. Selective enzymes interaction. So we have as enzymes interaction, we have, for example, the let's put MAO inhibitors, the monoamino oxidase inhibitor that is used for Parkinson. They are going to inhibit that enzyme. So what is doing that enzyme is at the end increasing the levels of dopamine. So for example, so it's just, oh, let's make it something more simple. The acetylcholinesterase, the cholinesterase enzyme, cholinesterase is inhibitors are going to inhibit the destruction of acetylcholine, right? So acetylcholine is going, if you do that, is going to increase the levels of acetylcholine, and that is going to be used, for example, for MS, the multiple sclerosis. They are going to actually be lack of acetylcholine. We want to increase the acetylcholine. Okay, so let's keep moving. Here we have the pharmacotherapeutics. I'm talking about pharmacotherapeutics. We've finished about the pharmacodynamics. So let's go over some definitions. Number one, contraindications. We already talked about contraindications. It's totally contraindicated to give some medications in certain situations. Pregnancy, warfarin, for example, right? Okay, so acute therapy, immediate and early for treatment management of the medical condition. So there is, it's not the same to treat the asthma right away than tomorrow. Because if you control earlier, the asthma is going to be very easy to control, or more easier to control than if you wait one day. After one day, your asthma is already, they need more time, your body, in order to start to control the bronchospasm. So it's acute therapies when you give the treatment in acute process. Maintenance therapy is mostly for chronic conditions or a maintenance condition. So they're going to keep the same therapeutic range to find the same therapeutic response to in the patient. Supplemental, we have, for example, loop diuretics. Loop diuretics is the water pill, right? The water pill. And a water pill is making you urinate more, right? More urination. All right, so more volume of urine. So at that time, when you are not able to reabsorb sodium, because that's what is doing the loop diuretic, Lasix, right? They are going to have, they are going to eliminate potassium too. So you're going to lose potassium. So if you lose potassium, it's a risk for arrhythmias. Arrhythmias can be, when the patient is diabetic or something, it's going to be worse even. That can lead into cardiac arrest. So what we are doing, supplementals. What is a supplemental of potassium? Is bananas, orange juice. So all these have content of potassium. Potassium, especially bananas. Okay, palliative is you don't treat the disease itself. The bottom line, you don't treat the disease. You are treating the signs and symptoms. Cancer, we don't have, you cannot do anything. We don't cure cancers, right? So the patient is in pain, so you need to make patient comfortable. So we need to give a palliative treatment. For example, we have this bottom machine release morphine. The patient can self-administer in certain amount, of course, and in certain dose too. So that is palliative. Supportive is fluids, nutrients, and it's going to be psychological too, but fluids, nutrients is an easy way to remember. Supportive, for example, support your normal function. Support your normal amount of fluid. So you need this amount of fluid every day. So we are going to have supportive treatment, okay? Prophylactic medication, antibiotics, for example, isoniazid. Isoniazid is anti-tuberculosis medication. Isoniazid or INH, INH is the same. Isoniazid, in the long run, what you go have a skin test and you have huge red spots in your arm for tuberculosis. Okay, so you're afraid to have tuberculosis. You go to the doctor, they tell you, go to have an x-ray. Go to have the x-ray, and the x-ray is clear, clean, nice. And you have, but you have a red spot. So that means that you have a huge, big contact with people who has tuberculosis before. So in order to prevent the eventuality situation that probably you can develop, you don't have that disease, but eventually you have higher risk to develop that disease. They are going to give prophylactic for 6 months. Isoniazid. This isoniazid, in addition, is going to deplete the amount of vitamin B6, the pyridoxine. If that happens, you have neuropathies. You have tingling, you have numbness. And what you're going to do is the supplement of vitamin B6. Okay, so this is two examples going about the isoniazid, the prophylactic medication, and the other one is the, as a consequence, they can, in this case, is going to deplete the, in the isoniazid, deplete the vitamin B6, and we need to give supplements of vitamin B6. Empiric, UTI infection, so by experience. Empiric means by experience. By experience, we know that UTIs mostly are the E. coli. E. coli. So we give medications to E. coli, but because the majority is like that. But we taking urine for culture, right? So meantime, you're taking medication that by experience, we know that E. coli, we are doing the culture in the lab. To confirm that is E. coli. If not, well, we find we already been covered by antibiotic, and we are going to call you and change the medication, if that is the case. So that is how empiric medication is going to work. Monitoring is how, therapeutic drug monitoring is the TDM, is the use of the drug concentration measurements in plasma. That is one way to monitor the medication. Another is to monitor the side effects or to monitor what is the effectiveness of the medication. For example, if you have pain, you need to assess the patient in about half an hour, where the absorption is the taking about half an hour for enteral absorption when you take the pill by mouth. It's about half an hour. So you start to take the monitoring of the effect, the effectiveness of the medication. Very important in your nursing assessment. Adverse effects, toxic effects, adverse effects, predictable adverse effects, and toxic effects are the degree of the drug can harm. So what is toxic? When you have toxic, any medication that is toxic, listen, are going to make a vessel that is normal, the lumen of the vessel is a normal size. What you have reached toxic levels, the vessels vasoconstrict. That is what is toxic. Toxic is going to make the vessel vasoconstricted. So when this vasoconstricted, they are going to have less oxygen, less blood supply. And that's why the toxic is going to damage kidney, because the kidney do not receive blood supply enough. Or hepatotoxicity, did not receive enough blood supply the liver, or ototoxicity, or neurotoxicity. So there's difference between so toxic levels, so don't forget that. So therapeutic index, we have, for example, you have a range of therapeutic effect. So let's make it is from 1 to 2. So 1 to 2. 1 to 2 is the therapeutic index. If you have, for example, there's medications who can be toxic levels 1, 2, and when they reach level concentration as 3, for example, not 3 times, but I give you a number, okay? So 3 is toxic levels there. But other, they have, and that therapeutic index is very wide, very big number, or larger number. But when you have a small number therapeutic index, that means that 1 to 2 is the therapeutic range. 1.1, 1.2 is already toxic. And that is a therapeutic index who is very narrow. And we need to be careful with those medications. For example, warfarin, digoxin. Warfarin is anticoagulant. We already know at this level, we know about warfarin. And we have a very wide number, wider therapeutic range, the safety, the amoxicillin. Drug concentration is the therapeutic response of toxic levels. So drug concentration, what is drug concentration? You ask 20 minutes lab test of the drug concentration in blood, in plasma. So in 20 minutes, it's coming, the result. So that is just to monitor and to check the drug concentration. Patient condition, physiological and psychosocial therapeutic response, a patient attitude and expectation affect the response to medication. Okay, so what does it mean? Okay, that means patient education. Patient education, the patient who doesn't know what is receiving or doesn't know what is that, they are not going to have the attitude to receive the medication and that is helping. See, remember the six dimensions of the person? Yeah, we are not a pill, we are not a liver, we are not a kidney, we are not gallbladder, right? So we are more than that. So that is relation to the six dimensions, don't forget that. Tolerance, dependence, physical and psychological dependence. Tolerance is decreasing response to repeat drug dose. Okay, so for example, you have a drug, you take the drug, and the drug is, you get tolerance, that means that to look for the same effect, you need to take more amount, more dose, and more dose, and more dose. But we are not actually a container, right? So there's a moment we can reach toxic levels, okay? All right, so tolerance. So for example, nitroglycerin, patches. Patches, you take a patch from the skin and clean the area and put another patch in other area different from the previous one. And the patch are going to be given in the morning and take it out at night. Put it in the morning because the patient is having nitroglycerin for angina, so chest pain. So the more activity, the most likely you can have chest pain. So that's why we give it in the morning. And why we take it at night? We take it at night because we don't want to create tolerance in the patient. So in the next day, in the morning, we are going to give it again. Okay, dependence is, for example, let's talk about, you can have dependent many drugs. Let's make a simple alcohol. Alcohol, you start to drink alcohol, you said, oh, I want alcohol, more alcohol, okay? More alcohol, one more glass. So you start to think about alcohol, I'm going to feel better, I'm going to take a glass of wine. And you keep thinking, and suddenly you start to have this almost obsessive thinking about, okay, so when is that time, my break, to have a glass or something, right? And that is thinking, thoughts, psychological dependence. And physical dependence is something is more advanced. So for example, alcohol, can lead psychological dependence and then physical dependence. After you stop the alcohol, okay, I have too much alcohol. I mean, wow, I don't want to be alcoholic, I'm going to stop. And then so that is your psychologically, you start to stop, but physically your body start to say something different. You start to shake, you have tremors, you have to sweat, you start to have nauseous, you start to have vomiting, and because your body is asking for more alcohol, and you can end into seizures, coma, and death. All right, so that is about physical and dependent and psychological. We have drug interactions. Remember, as the alteration of the effect of one drug by another drug. We have additive effects, synergetic effects, antagonic effects, and incompatibility. So we have, for example, aspirin and Motrin additive effects. So they are going to some effects of each of them. Synergetic, so they are going to even more than the summation of the effects of the, for codeine, for example, is, what is it, an opioid that is being used for coughing and is used for pain in this case. And if you use Tylenol or ibuprofen that are analgesics, they can actually have synergetic effects. Antagonistic effects are going to be the effect, for example, you have alcohol, you have the buzz, so you start to take caffeine, so you are actually antagonic effects, right? Incompatibility, so please just remember that in order to, even though I don't want you to remember at this moment of the ampicillin and gentamicin, when you cannot mix it in the same syringe. But what I want you to remember at this level is that when you are going to mix some medication, always read your drug reference book. Okay, always read your reference book because they can actually be incompatible. So that means they are going to antagonize, they are going to block each other, and they're not going to make any effect. Okay, so one of the tips or clues that I can tell you, if you mix something that are clear, and then you mix it and become cloudy or change color, that means that there's some reaction there that you don't want to have. All right, so be careful on that. All right, so that is crystallization. So we have here some cartoons that you can actually look around here. Okay, so we're talking about the grapefruit. So if you take the grapefruit, what is going to do? It's going to decrease the metabolism. You decrease metabolism, you're going to increase the active medication, so you can reach toxic levels, right? So now, if you take grapefruit, when you can take the next medication. So you need to wait about 24 hours. Okay, so last up to 24 hours. One glass of juice or two segments of grapefruit. So you need to actually the thing. So grapefruit can be two things. Number one, can delay or decrease the absorption, and they can decrease the effect of the GP for 450. All right, so more than 85, so it's 50 is more than that, it's 85 drug interaction. So what I prefer is not to give any medication with grapefruit. So we have displacement, interference, incompatibility. I'm not going to go on that, so you can stop the video if you want to read a little bit about this, but I'm not going to ask that. Adverse effects, adverse drug withdrawal effect, medication error, adverse drug reaction. Adverse effects is a broad spectrum of what undesirable medications. Adverse effects, drug withdrawal, so medications that you can, if you stop the medication abruptly or suddenly, they can produce a rebound effect. For example, we have antihypertensive. If you stop the antihypertensive suddenly, some medications can actually they can increase the heart blood pressure very suddenly, and that could put in risk the patient. Medication error, so one thing you need to remember about medication error, prevent. And we are going to use some rules about that. Six rights, for example. Adverse drug reaction is any reaction of a drug that is unexpected and undesirable and occurs therapeutic dose range. So it's adverse effects, reaction, you can call side effects. For example, your aspirin. I'm going to be the same because I don't want to give you too many different examples, because you need to get familiar before with the medication. Aspirin. Aspirin, you take medication, you have gastritis. Okay, that is an adverse reaction or side effects. All right, so we have here the six rights. Six rights, remember I was giving you the mnemonic Trump. No, politics is Trump. Trump is T-R-A-M-P. D, Trump. T, time. R is the route. A is the amount, is the dose. M is the medication, the right drug. P is the right patient. Trump, D, the documentation. Okay, so let's keep going. So response to drug, we have pharmacological reaction is an extension of that drug normal effect in the body. So we are going to talk about the desired effects, is the minimal side effects, is what is everybody want. You want to have benefit with a little bit of or none of this side effect. That is the desired effect. Side effects, one example, aspirin again. We have stomach irritation, gastritis. Adverse effects, we use people use in different, so I we use side effects as better, as more general. If you want, you can make some remarks if there's adverse effects. For example, aspirin can lead into bleeding. Idiosyncratic reactions are going to be aspirin can lead into asthma. So mechanism of action is prostaglandin. So at this moment, prostaglandin can produce bronchodilation. If you have aspirin, this is going to block one of the prostaglandins, leading into bronchospasm. So that is very rare. Idiosyncratic, it means unusual and unpredictable reaction. So that is mostly those related to the immune system. All right, so we have one thing, we have hypersensitivity, allergic reaction. What I want you to know is that we have hives and itching, especially in neck and face. Even if it's 1-2 millimeters, that is already allergic reaction. So be careful with that. 20 minutes observation. Bring your phenylethylamine, the Benadryl, and give it to the patient of observation. Take notes and probably bracelet if that is needed in order to have, for example, the next patient. What happened? Why bracelet? The patient is unconscious. The patient cannot say anything. So bracelet is going to help. All right, so allergic reactions, you have already that. Teratogenic means that produce malformations in the on the fetus. One simple, vitamin A, excess of vitamin A, or valproic acid for seizures. Vitamin A can produce cleft lip or cleft palate. Carcinogenic effects, actually it can be any substance that can produce cancer, for example, asbestos. For example, the ceiling, this popcorn ceiling, if this does get into your lung, this cannot be absorbable, cannot be dissolved, and produce irritation for 1 year, 10 years, 20 years, and then cancer. Carcinogenic effect. Mutagenic is permanent genetic, can change, for example, radiation, viruses, and benzene that is a cleaner substance. Pharmacognosia is where it's coming from, the drugs, plants especially, okay? Bacteria, genetic industry, so they can produce, make the bacteria produce certain enzymes or certain proteins. Pharmacoeconomics, cost-benefit analysis, is huge here, but I'm not going to go on that. But definitely it's a lot of competition, a lot of, I would like to say something here about, we have the, which medication is more effective? The one who is brand, have a brand name, pharmaceutic name, or the other one is generic name. So you know, you go to some store and you see generic and you see the brand name. Which one is better? Actually, the better is the one who has this brand name. Why? Because the generic name is cheaper because they don't have that many studies of pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics. Remember to make out in the market out a medication, they need to take about 10 to 20 years, 20, 20 years. And these generic are going to have less time. So it's going to be cheaper, less cost of studies, and they go into the market. But this is not going to be as effective as the brand name. That is what it is. Because the pharmaceutical, they have more study, more effectiveness, they have more trials, etc., etc., etc. All right, toxicology, we talk about that. Toxicology is a study of the toxic levels of the medication. We need to remember a few of them for NCLEX. You need to remember, for example, what digoxin, phenytoin, theophylline, vancomycin are very important. Lithium is very important. So we will see that on time. I have a mnemonic for you guys. So, but this is not a time yet. So let's keep going. We have the summary, pharmacokinetic, pharmacognosia, pharmacodynamics, therapeutic, and toxicology. All together, what we just talked is pharmacology. Pharmacology, right? So pharmacology remember, is the study of the drug interacting with the living organisms towards or through chemical processes. So there you are. You have all pharmacology in front of you. All right, so some review here. You can stop the video and start to recall what is absorption, distribution, etc., 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 and trying to remember with your notes that you, I'm sure you took it, to refresh all the information, recall information, please. So here we have acetaminophen. You have the absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion. Actually, this is acetaminophen is a painkiller and antipyretic, means history for fever. It's not for inflammation. Acetaminophen is not for inflammation. It's only for pain and fever. So you can see some examples about what happened with the Tylenol in your body, absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion. Okay, medication errors. We are going to have a few things here to talk, and we are finishing very soon. So preventable, we have medication errors. So you can prevent, that is the main thing. We have LASA, look alike, sounds alike drugs, so be careful with those drugs. So there is medication who are going to be a similar name. For example, I repeat, the acetosolamide. Acetosolamide is diuretic. And we have the acetohexamide. Those are anti-diabetic. So one is anti-diabetic medication, PO, and the other one is a diuretic. Totally different thing. Common drugs errors, so be careful, especially with central nervous system. medication, anticoagulants. So many people receive anticoagulants, pre-operative, post-operative, etc. For example, DVTs, strokes, right? Chemotherapy drugs are going to be mostly because the names are very similar most of the time, especially in the chemotherapy. So mostly when you are going to administer medication, because you're going to prescribe, transcribe, dispensing, administering, monitoring, and at any of these stages are going to be errors. The prescribing transcription mostly is about 50%. Meantime, together dispensing, administering, monitoring, especially dispensing and monitoring, is the other about 50%. So we don't care exactly what is the percentage. We know that we need to take care in every single step that we do. Higher risk for errors. And that is how you're going to learn how to administer medication. Okay, so so we have here prevention of medication errors. We have implement multiple system checks. So you need to triple check, three checks, right? The physician's order with a MAR. The MAR with the medications in front of you. And then the again, do it again in front of the patient. So that is implement the systems of check. Or you can be with somebody else to double check. Okay, so you do it here and show the your colleague, right? So together. And at the end, what you're doing is to sign both of you. Legible prescription orders. So you cannot guess, please. If you don't understand, it's not your fault. You need to call and actually ask for a legible order. Authoritative resources, you need to have your drug book reference, please, all the time in your pocket. Nurse check medication orders three times before, six rights. We already TRAMPD, right? Assessment, you need to assess, you need to know, for example, is the assessment of the medication is PO, you need to check in about half an hour, because PO is going to be absorbing about half an hour. You start to have IV is going to be early, 15 minutes, for example, but the assessment, but the effect is almost immediately. So you put the IV and the medication start to make effect right away, 5 minutes or less. Diuretics, for example, 5 minutes, okay, you start to pee more. So your assessment is going to be earlier than that, than 15 minutes. Two patients identifiers, okay? Two patient identifier bracelet is going to have the name and the date of birth. Do not administer if you don't not draw up the or prepare yourself. So please be careful. Don't give somebody or don't receive from anybody medical book. You don't know what is inside. So because you didn't do it, so be careful. Minimize verbal of telephone orders. So if you have a line of people and you say something in the ear, the person at the end of the line is going to tell you totally something different, right? So you need to avoid that. You need to prevent that. All right. So spell drug name aloud and return the repeat after the prescription verbally is given to you. Preventing medication errors, again, never assume anything about items not specifying order in drug orders. Okay, don't assume anything. So do not hesitate to question a medication order for any reason when there's a doubt. Never use a training zero with medication orders. So we are going to see some examples. Do not try to decipher or illegible written orders, content prescribed clarification, again. Learn special administration techniques or certain dosage forms. We are always verify new medication administration records. Always listen to honor and concern expressed by patients regarding medication. Please pay attention to that, open ears, open eyes. Always listen to and honor any concerns expressed by patients regarding medication. Okay? So you need to contact the prescriber if there is any doubt. So to complete these numbers is what I put here. For example, use 500 milligrams instead of, use 500 milligrams, yes, for or instead of 0.5. So the dots are being confusing sometimes. So please, just don't, you can confuse with 5 grams, for example. Use 125 micrograms instead of 0.25. For example, although 0.5, oh, 0.5 or 5? See, that is a mistake. So in this case, when it's 0.5, the dose, you need to put 0.5, okay? Colchicine is for gout. Is 1 milligram, not, you put 1 milligram, don't put 1.0, looks like 10 milligrams, okay? All right, so we need to make a space between the name and the dose, because sometimes, for example, Inderal can end in L, and L looks like 1. So instead to say Inderal 40 milligrams, you can read Inderal 140 milligrams, so be careful with that. All right, so in conclusion, we have here that at the beginning, here, for example, you need to have, you can put a zero. But at the end, it's better not to put any zero. For example, here, 0.125. Zero is on the front. Yes, it's okay, good. But you don't put zero here, so you can read 1,550 milligrams. That doesn't make sense, right? So you just put 125. So yes at the beginning, but no at the end. Yes at the beginning, but no at the end. Okay, so that is about the webinar today. Thank you so much. If there is any comment, so please just let me know, and I will be happy to answer your questions. Thank you so much.